Good morning. The risk of global recession is growing and cost of living pressures could be higher for longer. That is the stark new warning from the International Monetary Fund this morning. Federal politics reporter Ashley Wick has the details for us. Ash, it's a bleak forecast.
That's exactly right, Lizzie. The world's economy is entering a perilous phase. That is according to the IMF's latest reading on the global economic outlook. It warns rising interest rates are weakening growth, inflation is yet to turn the corner, and the risk of recession is increasing in some countries. What it describes as feeble and uneven economic growth is forecast for the rest of the decade. Global growth has also been downgraded to 2.8% from 3.4% last year. Australia's growth forecast down to 1.6%.
Financial risks have increased, yet inflation has not decisively turned the corner. Policymakers will need a steady hand and clear communication. With financial instability contained, monetary policy should remain focused on bringing inflation down.
Treasurer Jim Chalmers heads to the US today for a series of meetings on the state of the global economy. He will be joined by Reserve Bank Governor Philip Lowe, the pair to attend meetings with some of the world's top economic agencies, discussions that are set to influence the May budget.
The economy will slow, and that's why this budget is so important in a little under 4 weeks' time, because what we need to do is provide some responsible cost of living relief without adding to inflation.
The Treasurer says next month's budget is all about striking the right balance between dealing with immediate challenges, preparing for the future, and protecting Australia's economy against global shocks. Lizzie
Ashwick there in Canberra. The gunman behind the deaths of five people at a Kentucky bank bought his AR-15 assault rifle legally a week ago. That's according to police, who today released the body cam footage of the swift response by officers. US correspondent Jonathan Kersley has more.
This footage captures the tense 4 minutes after officers arrived at the Old National Bank, Louisville, in Kentucky. It was 8:41 in the morning. Officers Nicholas Wilton, Corey Galloway get out of their car and approach the bank. In the foyer is Connor Sturgeon, armed with an AR-15 assault rifle police say he purchased legally a week ago. By the time these images are taken, he had already killed and is waiting for officers to arrive. He can see them, but they can't see him. Officers move closer. Then you can hear a blast of gunfire. This footage is from Corey Galloway's body cam. He was hit and rolled but got back on his feet. His colleague, Nicholas Wilt, a new recruit, was shot in the head almost immediately. 4 minutes after they arrive, Galloway moves up the stairs and the gunman is dead. Sturgeon had killed five people and injured eight others. The officer's actions have been described as not perfect, but heroic.
As a profession, we are here to save people. And even though we saved lives that day, there are people that lost theirs.
Nicholas Wilt remains in a critical condition in hospital, and the scourge of gun violence in the US prompted a senior doctor in Louisville to issue this emotional plea on gun control. Do something, he says.
I'm weary. There's only so many times you can walk into a room and tell someone they're not coming home tomorrow. And it just breaks your heart. When you hear someone screaming, Mommy or Daddy, it just becomes too hard day in and day out to be able to do that.
The Louisville shooting was the 146th mass shooting in the US in 100 days this year, and a new survey of 1,200 people has found one in five Americans have a relative who was shot dead by a gun.
The devastated parents of a Victorian high school student who died after inhaling harmful chemicals are vowing to educate others about the dangers. 13-year-old Ezra Haynes went into cardiac arrest after the chroming accident on the weekend. Her family say they will make it their life mission to make sure other children avoid falling into the same trap. Police are hunting for a driver who ran from the scene of a major accident in Sydney's southwest. Hayley Francis reports.
Residents of Lawford Street here at Greenacre say they thought they heard a bomb blast around 7:30 last night when a car crashed not only into one car, but then a tree and then a second car.
It hit about two cars and then it just went back to another car and went up the top. It was really bad. I came outside, I found the car right on top of the other car and I was screaming, like, take the people out of this car.
The Audi Q3, with all of its airbags deployed, finally came to a rest on top of a disability van belonging to a family here on this street. Last night, both of their cars were written off. Despite the chaos, the driver of the Audi was nowhere to be found. Dozens of residents ran out of their homes almost immediately after the crash, but no one saw the driver or any passengers flee the scene. Police now testing DNA left at the scene, hoping it will lead them to a suspect. Anyone with dash cam footage or information is urged to contact police.
A driver has escaped injury after his truck rolled over in Adelaide's east. Emergency crews were called to the scene just before 7 p.m. last night at Mile End South. The crash caused major traffic delays. There's a large-scale search at two landfill sites as police investigate the disappearance of former Queensland teacher Leslie Trotter. Police believe her remains were inside a wheelie bin which was removed by a rubbish truck. Andrea Crothers has more.
Investigators have quarantined off areas within landfills at Rochdale and here at Swanbank Ipswich as they prepare to go through tonnes of waste piece by piece in the search for Leslie Trotter's remains. Police have evidence the 78-year-old's body was inside a wheelie bin outside her Toowong unit, picked up by garbage collectors on March 28. That trash, including her remains, was dumped at a facility in Nudgee, along with 22 other truckloads of rubbish. That was all compressed before being taken in six separate trucks to two landfill sites, where police are now focusing their investigation. Officers aren't ruling out the possibility that Leslie Trotter's habit of going through neighbours' bins to remove items from general waste to recycling may have been a factor in her disappearance. But so far, police don't have any suspects, have limited security footage from the street Miss Trotter lived on, and despite the obvious enormous challenges that come with scouring through two-week-old landfill, they are determined to find out what really happened to the retired schoolteacher.
One of Australia's most celebrated artists, John Olsen, has died overnight, aged 95. Olsen was the winner of the Archibald, Wynne and Sulaiman Prizes. One of his paintings, Salute to Five Bells, hangs in the Sydney Opera House. Next month, the landmark sales will be lit up with a tribute to Mr. Olsen during the Vivid Festival. Fresh concern this morning over a surge of violence in New South Wales schools. The number of assaults has doubled in the past 10 years, with police being notified an average of 10 times every school day. The Bureau of Crime Statistics and Research says police were called nearly 2,000 times last year. It's been revealed Victoria's government spent almost $3 million of taxpayer money on state funerals last year. The farewell of cricket legend Shane Warne was the most expensive, costing $1.6 million for the MCG send-off. The emotional goodbye of four police officers killed in the Eastern Freeway tragedy was the second most costly, followed by acclaimed musician Archie Roach. A driver has left a big mess after smashing into parked cars in the early hours of this morning. Two cars were damaged in the incident in Russell Lee. Police are questioning the female driver.